Hello everyone and welcome to my guide for nonlinear dynamics. In this video, we're going to be introducing nonlinear dynamics by analyzing first order differential equations, or ODEs. Let's start out with a very simple example. Suppose we have a particle that's constrained to move along the x-axis, with its position given by x of t, x as a function of time. The differential equation describing the particle's motion is dx by dt is some function of x. Now in this differential equation, x is a real valued function of time, which represents the position of the particle, while dx by dt represents the rate of change of position, or the velocity of the particle along the x-axis, which is some function of the position of the particle on the x-axis. So this means that if you give me the current position of the particle, I can tell you the velocity of the particle by evaluating f of x, and then give you the future position of the particle from the velocity. This is in contrast to a more general ODE, like dx by dt is some function of both x and t. In this case, we need two pieces of information, both x and t, to predict the future position of the particle. As a result, we call this ODE a two-dimensional dynamical system, while this ODE would only be a one-dimensional dynamical system, since we only need one piece of information to predict the particle's future state. Now let's look at a particular example of the particle's motion. Suppose dx by dt equaled cosine of x. And say we wanted to find the position of the particle as time went to infinity, for an arbitrary initial condition, x of 0 equals x naught. Now, if you took a beginner's calculus course or a simple ODEs class, you would know that you'd have to solve this differential equation and then take the limit of the resulting function as t went to infinity. So let's start with that. Now, this is a separable ODE, so I can separate the variables by moving cosine x to the left and dt to the right, which gives me dx over cosine x equals dt. Now, after integrating both sides, here's what I'll have. The integral of secant x dx, 1 over cosine x is secant x, gives me just t plus some arbitrary constant. Now, if you look up an integration table, you'll see that the integral of secant x is ln of the absolute value of secant x plus tan x, and that equals t plus c. To find the value of the integration constant, you can substitute in the initial condition. So at x of 0, t equals 0, and x equals x naught. So this is what we have. T is just 0, so 0 plus c is just c, and we have c equals ln of the absolute value of secant x naught plus tangent of x naught, which means that our full solution is just t equals ln of the absolute value of secant x plus tangent x over secant x naught plus tangent x naught, after I move c to the left-hand side and isolate my t. But we still need to check what happens when t approaches infinity. So when t approaches infinity, the denominator in the ln expression is just a constant, meaning the numerator has to approach infinity. So we just have secant x plus tangent x going to infinity. Now I can rewrite these trigonometric ratios in terms of just sines and cosines. 1 over cosine x plus sine x over cosine x approaches infinity. Now this happens when the denominator of these, which is cosine x in both cases, approaches 0, which occurs for x equals odd integer multiples of pi by 2. So pi by 2, 3 pi by 2, 5 pi by 2, and so on. But suppose my initial value of x, or x naught, suppose it equaled 2 pi. So that means I'd have to decide between 3 pi by 2 and 5 pi by 2 as my limiting values of x. So which one should I pick? I mean, my particle's position obviously can't approach both values as t approaches infinity. I could graph this expression, but what if I ask you to give me the answer in 5 minutes? Could you? Probably not. What if instead of cosine x in my differential equation, I had dx by dt equals x cubed minus sine x? This is much, much harder to integrate, and you probably couldn't do it without hitting up your buddy Wolfram Alpha. But what if I told you that you could find the behavior of a solution to an ODE without actually solving the ODE? This is what nonlinear dynamics is all about, examining the solutions to differential equations without actually solving those equations. So let's just go back to our original differential equation, dx by dt equals cosine x. Let's make a plot of dx by dt as a function of x. Let me just label the axis, negative 5 pi by 2, negative 3 pi by 2, negative pi by 2, and same for the positives. And let's draw the graph of cosine x. So cosine x is 1 at x equals 0, 0 at pi by 2, goes to negative 1 in the middle, and comes back up, and it's the same on the left-hand side. Now look at the points where dx by dt equals 0. These points are called fixed points. Why? Because at these values of x, the particle isn't moving because its velocity that's given by dx by dt is 0. In other words, the particle is fixed in position, it's stationary. So these yellow points would be your fixed points, and they're also called stationary points. But what if I'm not situated at a fixed point? What if my particle is somewhere between negative pi by 2 and pi by 2? What happens? Well, my derivative, or my rate of change of x, is positive in this region, which means that my x wants to increase. And where's the direction of increasing x? It's to the right. I could say the same thing about any other region where the derivative is positive. So here my x would want to move to the right, here my x would want to move to the right, and so on. Now, what if I'm between pi by 2 and 3 pi by 2? Well, here my derivative is negative, so my x wants to decrease. It wants to go to the left. So wherever my derivative is negative, my x wants to head to the left because the rate of change of x is negative. Now, what does this mean if I start at pi by 2, but I perturb my particle slightly away from it? If I perturb it to the right, it's going to come back to the left because x wants to move left in this region. And if I perturb it to the left, it's going to come back right. So pi by 2, this fixed point, will attract particles in its vicinity towards it. And this is what we call a stable fixed point. This, similarly, would also be a stable fixed point, and so would this because it attracts the particle towards it. Now, if I start at 3 pi by 2, and I perturb my particle slightly away from it, instead of going back to 3 pi by 2, it's going to shoot away from it, because if I perturb it to the left, the particle is going to continue to the left because of the sign of the derivative. If I perturb it to the right, it's going to continue to the right because of the sign of the derivative. So in this case, our 3 pi by 2 would be an unstable fixed point. The same would apply to negative pi by 2 and negative 5 pi by 2. Now we can finally answer the question. Going back to the original initial condition that I asked in sort of a side question, if my x naught started out at 2 pi, if my particle started out at 2 pi, which is right over here between 3 pi by 2 and 5 pi by 2, where is it going to go as time approaches infinity? Well, you can see from the sign of the derivative, it wants to go to the right. So it's going to go to the right and eventually approach 5 pi by 2. And this is a stable fixed point. So as t approaches infinity, x would approach 5 pi by 2 for this initial condition. Now keep in mind that on its approach, the particle will never overshoot 5 pi by 2. It will exponentially converge to it. Once it reaches 5 pi by 2 at infinite time, it's going to stop, since the derivative is 0 and the particle won't go anywhere.